The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Let's go to Colorado Springs, Colorado, where Reverend Stephany Rose Spaulding is standing by. She is a senior pastor at Ebenezer Baptist Church of Colorado Springs, and she is the Democratic nominee for Colorado's 5th Congressional District. She is endorsed by Howie Klein and the Blue America PAC. Thank you so much for taking time to be with us.
Thank you for having me.
Well, I guess the first question is, should he be confirmed?
Lord, no, he should not be confirmed. And not just because of the hearings, but definitely the hearings highlight why he should not be confirmed. And I'm just really disappointed that we have devolved to this point in terms of our governance, as well as the branches of legislation. And it's just baffling to me. And I feel for Dr. Ford on this day. I feel for her, as well as anyone who has been victimized through sexual assault.
How do men make good for their past sins?
First of all, it starts with acknowledging that there is a problem, right? That we cannot move forward if we don't believe that there's a problem. I have seen tweets that, you know, from people, regardless of gender, who are saying boys will be boys. And this is a situation of a young man who is just acting as a boy, as a, you know, as the normalized behavior for his gender. And for me, as a professor of women's and ethnic studies, that's exactly the problem, that we have socialized masculinity in this way and to not see it as a problem. So the first step is to see that there are problems with it, and then we can go in and address it. The better thing for Kavanaugh to have done in this situation was to acknowledge early on that I probably did behave in this way, whether it was getting drunk and not being aware of my surroundings and beings, I probably did behave in this way. That would have carried so much more weight than where we are right now.
If you were a United States senator and somebody said, look, I was drinking 36 years ago, I did horrible things, I don't remember, but if this woman claims I did it, I'll take her word for it. I'm not the same person I was back then. I was a borderline alcoholic. I apologize. Would you
That's a person. I could actually vote for that person to take responsibility, to admit I probably did all of these things and had no inkling to even think they were wrong. I am a different person right now, and I don't ever want to be that person again. That's someone who takes onus and accountability for their actions, and even the ways, again, that we have socialized masculinity in this country. So, yes, I would have been more supportive of a human being who does that. Now, there are policy issues that I don't necessarily agree with,
right,
for Kavanaugh. But that person, I don't care what party line you are walking, is such a better person in my perspective.
We're talking with Stephany Rose Spaulding. She is running for Colorado's 5th Congressional District. If you're listening to us in America, you can donate money by going to StephanyRoseForCongress.com. Let me spell Stephany, S-T-E-P-H-A-N-Y, Stephany Rose for Congress.com. And you can give her money if you live in America or Russia. In America, we take money. I'm kidding. I usually don't like talking to candidates about their personal history because it's like waving the flag. It's a distraction. I want to know where you stand on the issues, because you're going to end up getting elected and being a loyal foot soldier for Steny Hoyer and Nancy Pelosi. You're going to do what you're told, and I need you there obeying the speaker, whoever that person is. So I don't really care what your story is. I just want to make sure you're going to vote for the things that I believe in. But character does count, and history does count, as we're seeing in yesterday's hearings with Brett Kavanaugh. You are a reverend, and you have a doctorate in what?
American Studies.
American Studies. Where'd you grow up?
I grew up on the south side of Chicago.
I was just watching Quincy on Netflix. What a story. If you have time, I know you're busy. The documentary about Quincy Jones. He's from the south side of Chicago. Where did you go to high school?
I went to Morgan Park High School, and I actually started there in seventh grade for a program. It was an advanced placement program. And then after high school, I went to Atlanta for undergrad. I went to Clark Atlanta, which is a historically black college in Atlanta. And then for grad school, I went to Purdue University for my master's and PhD.
How did you end up becoming a reverend?
When I moved out to Colorado, I was very much looking for community, had no idea that I would go into pastoring or even ministry. But 2 years into my experience here in Colorado, I found a community, and it's not the easiest place. It wasn't the easiest place to actually find that community. So I went into a congregation that really helped me find space and relationship to call Colorado Springs home. Mm-hmm. And while you know, being early there, for me, in faith, there's scripture that says your gifts will make room for you. Mm-hmm. And the people of the congregation saw something in me that I had not necessarily been exploring for myself. And that's how I got on the path of ministry.
You know, I love Howie Klein. I'm listening to you talk. And, you know, I have this rule. I listen to Ralph Nader and do what he tells me to do. And I listen to Howie Klein. And he says to have you on the show, and you're like, my eyes are welling up. I love Howie Klein so much. Stephany Rose for Congress.com. That's Stephany, S-T-E-P-H-A-N-Y. And what generation do you fall under? X, baby boomer, Y, Z, whatever. I'm not going to ask you. I'm not going to get too personal, but I want to know if you cross paths with Obama.
I am a little before the millennial generation. I got the tail end of the 1970s, born in 78.
Okay.
So, yeah, I'm a Gen Xer.
Did you ever see President Obama in Chicago?
I did not see him in Chicago. And again, when he came on the scene, it was phenomenal for me as well. A friend of mine was running at the same time for an aldermanic race in Chicago that he was running for his first term in office. And it was, well, in for the presidency. And it was just electric.
The impression that I got watching the hearings is there's a problem with rape, sexual assault, toxic masculinity. And I want to talk to you about that. Are you a product, though, of public or private schools? Because I think there's also a problem with elite private schools where Dr. Ford's father, who was president of the Burning Tree Country Club, which didn't allow African Americans or women up until a few years ago, she comes from a background where the father thought he could keep his daughter safe by sending her to a school surrounded by our own. And it turns out you can't really keep your kids safe in these elite private schools. I would even argue they might be more dangerous than public schools. Less oversight. So, less oversight and more concern with reputation. So are you a product of public schools of Chicago or private schools of Chicago?
I am a product of public schools, and both my parents were public school educators in Chicago. And to some extent, there is a level of privilege in which those who are in elite private schools, particularly well-to-do white males, they are not punished at the same rate that those who are in a different class setting mm-hmm. are. But you're right. In regards to masculinity, there's really no safe space for women, whether you're on a public campus or a private campus. What we tend to find is the rate in which punishment is not necessarily equitably dished out. So you're at risk wherever you are. The statistics are staggering for the number of women who will experience sexual assault in their lives. And that has very little to do with being in public or private space. And then on the other end of that, when you don't have the resources to report, it becomes that much more problematic. So violence against women happens at all class levels.
You went to an elite private black college in Georgia?
Yes.
Why did your parents send you to an all black college?
Because I was adamant about where I was going. For my parents, I could have gone anywhere, but I had a sister who was already in Atlanta at another elite private black school who's 2 years older than I am. And I was dead set on being in Atlanta, not necessarily with her, but with her. Right.
Mm-hmm. What is the benefit for an African-American to go to an all black college?
So it is one of the best spaces where African-Americans can actually excel academically. I'm not saying that it cannot happen in other places, but we are able to, and I say this as a student, as well as someone who has taught at a historically black institution, it's a place where black students do not feel that they are reminded daily in the classroom about their blackness and the impact of their race on their intellectualism. Mm-hmm. So you are able to remove that from the education process. And so that students are able to just be students on campus. Moving from an HBCU to a PWI, which is a predominantly white institution, I dramatically felt the difference. And you hear this from student African-American students across the board, that there is a barrier to being successful in obtaining your academic degrees when you know that race is factored into your educational process. So that is the benefit for me as a former student, alumni, as a former professor, educator, and even as someone who one day who might have children and have to think about how my children will be educated.
If you were born in 1978, and I'm sorry, but this involves math, I would assume you started college around 1996. I got that right. 1996.
That's right.
Okay, good. Whew. All right. So 1996, you were part of a generation of African Americans who were going to a black college was your choice. Is that fair to say that maybe?
Absolutely.
Yeah. When did it become more of a choice than a fait accompli?
So around the 1970s, there began to be a shift. It's not to say that you didn't have black people going to school in predominantly white institutions, but after the 70s and the introduction of the 80s, the civil rights movement, it was more of a push to be educated at elite white institutions. That was the part of desegregation after the civil rights movement and even black power movement was integration. Integration really helped people of color, specifically black people, to be in a place of choice as it comes down to educational opportunities.
Right. Is the hope that black colleges will eventually no longer be known as black colleges? Is that where we're hoping to get in, what, 50 years? Is that the goal?
I doubt that that's the goal. And that's not to say that more students will not attend HBCUs because of their makeup and composition.
What is the initial? What does that mean?
HBCU, so historically black college and university.
Okay.
In the same way, so like that question, will Notre Dame ever not be a Catholic, you know?
Right,
or
right.
Is the desire for it not to be what it is, or Jesuit schools to not be Jesuit schools? I don't think that that's the hope, but that is the history of how and why we have historically black institutions.
Yeah, and they have found that women in elementary school and high school, and they're separated from men in school, they learn better.
In some instances,
yeah.
I'm not a huge advocate of gender-based learning, but in some instances, yes, because they don't have the same kind of threats with assault or gender deficit in the way that teaching happens sometimes. So there are some benefits that educators have found.
Religion. Let's talk about your religion and how it informs your politics. You became a reverend. How do you become a reverend, a pastor? What do you need? What do you need to call yourself a pastor?
This is probably one of the most unknown processes, and it's so different across the board. So for the congregation that I pastor, it is a Baptist congregation, and we are a part of the American Baptist. We're affiliated with American Baptist. One thing that is unique or different about American Baptist as a denomination is that it does not work in the same way in terms of a unifying body like United Methodist or even Catholicism for others. So every single church that is Baptist gets to call their own pastor. So you have to have the confidence and the support of the congregation itself in order to pastor. To become a minister, you can go through several different processes, whether that is being licensed by the body. So again, like I said, I'm American Baptist. You can be licensed to minister by the body of American Baptist or Progressive Baptist, National Baptist. Those are different denominations under the Baptist umbrella. You can be licensed by that organization, or you can have a local license and a local ordination, meaning the congregation and the body that they respect has ordained you to preach and to pastor.
So in the Catholic Church, priests get assigned by the archdiocese, and
yes,
it's not democratic. In the Baptist religion in America, it's more inclusive. Your leader is kind of picked by.
Yes.
I see.
Yep.
And so you have to play to your followers.
Yes.
What happens if you say things that they disagree with?
So for me, the congregation itself was in search of a pastor, and I was a member at the time of the congregation who had been licensed under the former pastor, the founding pastor of the congregation. We were collectively looking for someone, and apparently they were just waiting for me to step up and say, okay, I'll do it. But that was very much a part of the conversation in our process, because I am extremely committed to feminist ideology, diverse and inclusive ideology. And I put it on the table. I was like, you all know who I am, right? Like, you know what I teach, you know what I do, how I am in community. And they were like, and that's exactly why we want you.
Right.
Because they did not want someone who would discriminate. They did not want someone who will not take a stand on issues of civil rights. And so that's why we work well together. I don't know if I will ever pastor another congregation. Right now, I'm pastoring this congregation because we fit and we have been called together.
So when you're pastoring, are you also teaching?
Yep.
Where do you teach?
I teach at the University of Colorado here in the Springs.
Where was Ward Churchill from?
He was in Boulder.
Ah, okay. This is what I tell Republicans. I'm a Jew, and I'm a better Christian than you'll ever be. And that's, and that scares me because I'm a lifelong Democrat, and I worry that the Democratic Party makes perfect sense for good and decent Christians. Ted Lieu, congressman from California, is reaching out to the evangelicals, the Baptists, the Christians, and he's saying, you belong with us. It makes perfect sense if you're a Christian. The nuns on the bus showing up at Speaker Ryan's office and saying, you call yourself a Catholic? My concern is it makes so much sense for all the Christians and the evangelicals to become Democrats. I worry that this is going to become the Christian party, the party of Jesus. And that could be a problem for the Democrats. Is there room in politics for religion? I think not.
This, for me, is a more complex conversation.
Yes.
I think for anyone who is walking the planet and has a faith tradition, that you cannot parse and piece that out of them. And I say this from a very cultural as well as historical place, right? For African Americans to survive in the United States, spirit and faith was an absolute necessary. And I don't call that religion. I'm speaking very specifically about spirit and faith. We would not be on the planet given everything that has happened to Black people across the planet if we were not people of deep spiritual commitment.
And Martin Luther King was a minister, a reverend, but he wasn't a politician. He influenced Lyndon Johnson, but we wouldn't have a Civil Rights Act if it weren't for Congress. And so there's a place for religion and there's a place for politics.
Right. So that's what I'm saying. Like for people in their own personal being, like you cannot piece their spirit out of them. But when it comes to the governance of our nation and communities, whether that's at local government or at the federal level, there is a reason why religion should not be how we govern one another, because we are a diverse nation of multiple religions that have to honor and respect the existence of everyone's religion. Like that is written into our constitution. It is the fabric of who we are as a democratic republic. So I think that so often religion as an organized institution has gotten away from us and has influenced politics in ways that is extremely problematic. What to your point about the nuns showing up at Speaker Ryan's, the reality is people do not, a lot of folks who are in positions of leadership are not actually living their faith, because if they were, we would not have the level of angst and disregard for other people's humanity. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes, yeah. Can you, when you're elected to Colorado's 5th Congressional District, you'll vote ecumenically? You'll vote non-denominationally?
Absolutely. Non-denominationally. It really is about how do we uphold the laws of our country as well as honoring people's human dignity. So even if the laws are unrighteous, because of course it was legal to own slaves, that does not honor human dignity.
Right. But they did use the Bible to justify slavery.
And they used it completely wrong.
So is there room in the Democratic Party for people of faith?
Absolutely. I think there's room. And I think there's room for people to also check their biases. Absolutely.
Does God belong in politics? Do we have a problem with too many politicians referring to God and Jesus? And
I think we have a problem with how people understand God and Jesus. For me personally, I think there's a whole lot of misrepresentation. And what we tend to blame on God is not God at all.
I think we should deal with the scene when we go to Washington, not the unseen. Well, let me ask you some difficult questions.
Mm-hmm.
Is there room in the Democratic Party for people who oppose abortion?
That's a hard one.
Yeah. I mean, as a man, you know, and I've said this to the women in my life who are all Democrats, you know, we could win if we just took abortion off the table. We could win over all the evangelicals and bring them to our side if we just... Abortion is really, really important to women. And
I don't know that I want to win that way.
Yeah.
You know?
So I'm not even asking you where you stand on abortion, but I'm asking you, can a candidate say, you know what, I'm not running on abortion. I'm running on unions, jobs, bringing the troops home, gun control, and the environment. Abortion is not my issue. Can a candidate talk that way to voters?
Yes, a candidate could. I don't know that they should in this political climate. The reality is women's health is under attack. And the fact that we allow the conversation to be led by abortion and not talking about what is happening to access to health care for women is an extreme problem for me. That does include being able to articulate women's right to choice. And if that choice means that they need to have an abortion and a safe one, then we have to take a stance on it. I don't think that we win any race in 2018 today being wishy-washy, right? Like mm-hmm. trying to be lukewarm. You have to either be for it or tell the truth and let people know where you stand. For me, women have to have the right to the autonomy of their bodies. And it's something that I'm not willing to back down on. And I say that from a place of faith. I say that knowing that there are reasons for the protection and the sanctity of life for a mother, that it has to be available.
Yeah, how do you square that with being a practicing Baptist?
And that's the point. Most people, for most people who make the argument, they aren't even really reading the Bible. It is... there's a formula that is laid out in the Old Testament for how to conduct an abortion.
Really?
Yes, really. Which is why in Judaism, you don't have as much of a problem around this, because there is reason for the protection of a woman's life. There's a reason for the protection of family, for why things have to be able to move forward. And again, what we're really arguing is whether or not women have autonomy over their bodies.
As a white man who kind of skated through life compared to most of my fellow citizens, I'm beginning to see the way Brett Kavanaugh viewed Dr. Ford when she was 15, and seeing the link between holding her down and covering her mouth and Roe v. Wade. It's not just about attempted rape or rape. That was a violent mm-hmm. assault. There is a connection to abortion, because the more I listen, the more I realize that forbidding women from getting abortions is control, isn't it?
Absolutely.
I hear myself saying it. I am beginning to understand that abortion is about controlling women. I don't understand it. I'm not trying to sound self-righteous and woke. You know, I hate everybody. I hate men and women. But how is it possible that, like, why would you want to control a woman? I don't understand that.
So there are multiple reasons, and other experts better than I who know the history and the stats better. But part of one reason is how women play in the economy. And we know globally that when women are not able to control or to plan their family, then they have less wealth. They have less opportunity to enter an economic market.
I don't want to talk about my personal life, but there have been women I've wanted to have sex with. There have been marriages that have failed, relationships that have failed. I've wanted women in my life to do what I wanted to do. I don't want to do what they want to do because I don't like doing what they want to do. I want to do what I want to do. So that's controlling a woman, isn't it? So then if you're in a relationship and you get a woman pregnant or she becomes pregnant and you force her to have the baby, then you can control her economic destiny. She's going to be more dependent on me because she has to be home with the baby, right?
In the way that we have gendered work and domestic life in the United States and elsewhere throughout the country, it does. The most time that women are out of the economic market is during childbearing years.
If I want a woman.
So, okay, we're filtering it through you. So you and your wife, I don't know when, I have no idea, David, like what your life was, but I'm just talking hypothetically. If you and your wife got married when you were in your 20s and she got pregnant, who's not going to work?
Well, I wanted her. I wanted to be a kept man. But Yeah.
Exactly. And so when that happens, when you're 16, when it happens multiple times going forward, then that's also time that you are not in the workforce. And it's not to say that women who have children are not working, but that is the preponderance of the behavior, is that when women are not in control of their family planning, they are kept out of the economic market at higher rates than their counterparts.
The woman is home and I'm off working. I can control her with money.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we don't talk about how people control each other with money. Mm-hmm. That, I think there's a disconnect in explaining abortion. We don't talk about money in America and the way people are controlled by who has it, who makes it, and who gets suspended. And that's related to abortion and a woman's right to choose.
Right. And to tie it to assault, it's one of the primary reasons why domestic violence victims do not leave their relationships, because they don't have the economic means to do so.
Right. I've been in work relationships where I've stayed. The boss was abusive, but I figured I needed the money. Nobody else would hire me. That is how sometimes men like me experience abusive relationships. And they're really no different than abusive marriages.
Yep.
And if we can change the culture, like get rid of Les Moonves over at CBS.
Yes.
It's not just women. It benefits men. It's not a zero-sum game. But it's hard.
That's why we made Ruth Bader Ginsburg, because she was able to make the gender and the sexist argument with men to help them see how sexism is problematic for men as well.
Yeah. First, I'm going to thank Howie Klein. And I want to tell people that if you love Howie Klein, who art in heaven, hallowed be his name. I have two people who I take my marching orders from, Ralph Nader and Howie Klein. And so maybe you as well, if you'll come back. Stephany Rose, that's Stephany, Stephany Rose for Congress.com. If you live in America, go to StephanyRoseForCongress.com and give her a dollar. If everybody listening gave her a dollar, she could become our next congressperson from Colorado's 5th district. And you're in a tough race. You're in a pretty conservative district. NORAD is located in your district. James Dobson's Focus on Family, which is dedicated to conservative Christian values, is headquartered in your district.
Yes.
Wisconsin Governor Scott Walker was born in Colorado Springs, and he is synonymous with union busting. It's a pretty conservative Christian district. How are you doing in the polls?
Well, I will say at our primary cycle, I was 6 points different from the incumbent. I received about 45,000 votes, and he received about 54,000 votes.
Wow.
Yep.
Wow. And you are the Democratic nominee.
I am the Democratic nominee.
That is, you know, that says a lot about our party. Are you getting any help from the DCCC?
We are not getting from the DCCC.
All
and
right.
That is unfortunate in its own right, but it's not keeping us from moving this mountain. We have defied odds in so many ways.
What do you see happening on Election Day in general for this country?
I think there are going to be a lot of people who go to bed shocked out of their minds in the way that we saw with Ayanna Pressley.
In Massachusetts,
Yes, the way that Connor Lamb, special election, Doug Jones, Alabama. I think that this will shock the nation.
You're an African-American woman.
Yes.
Are we a good country?
Absolutely.
Why?
I think that.
Why?
Well, because the ideas and the principles for which we strive for are some of the best that I can imagine. And I'll say we may not be there yet, but the fact that we are working consistently for it, that is my hope. And I am grateful to be here in this nation, because there are places for all the problems that we experience. There is tremendous privilege to be here.
Yeah. And you're not entitled to stay home on Election Day. A lot of people, especially African Americans and women, died for the right to vote. So do not stay home on Election Day. Go to StephanyRoseForCongress.com. It's an honor to talk to you, Reverend. Stay on the line for 1 second, please.
Yes.
Thank you. Republican senators say the Judiciary Committee will vote at 9:30 a.m. today on whether or not to recommend Brett Kavanaugh to the Supreme Court. For more on this, we're joined by Dave Sirus. Did you watch the hearing, sir?
Much of it, yes. I watched the last 2 hours of Dr. Ford, and then I watched like the last 3 hours of I was running around, but I saw a good amount of it. I think I got the gist of it. A lot of crying, a lot of victimization, of course, talking about Kavanaugh.
Mm-hmm.
This is quite a one. You don't get many one story news days anymore, do you? And that's what we had today. This was a big one. I don't know where you want to start, but.
Well, let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
Do you believe in God?
Yes, that was a good question, wasn't it? An appropriate question on the Senate floor or the hearing chamber.
Yeah. Senator John Kennedy.
Yeah,
no relation. No relation whatsoever.
Yeah.
Do you believe in God? He asked.
David, it's a fair question because, you know, obviously atheists have, you know, much higher rape rates. You know, I mean, the prisons are essentially filled with them.
Yeah.
It's just, it's an atheist palooza in there.
Yeah.
In the prisons.
And then he says, I couldn't have raped this woman. I was in church, as though that's place where rape never takes place.
Is Kavanaugh a Catholic?
Yes, he is. Yeah.
Because I saw people making that reference. And I personally, I think that's unfair to the Catholic Church to wrap this into that.
I don't think there are any Protestants on the Supreme Court. I think they're either Jewish or Catholic. I'm pretty sure. Yeah. Go ahead.
Well, no, I just thought it was interesting because someone I know made a very good point, and then someone said a very stupid point about it. Someone said about why is it that no one ever questions when a man says he was molested 35 years ago? No one ever says, you know, you probably don't remember it right, but it's different when it's a teenage girl. And then someone said, how dare you compare this to the Catholic Church? What they did was much worse. And it's like, why? Like, it seems like a pretty apples to apples comparison. You know, if a man says when he was molested at 7, we find that much more believable than a woman saying she was attacked at 15.
Do you think he's lying?
Kavanaugh?
Yeah.
Oh my God, he's lying.
Do you think he knows he's lying?
Well, here's the thing. I think there's a very good chance that he does believe he's a victim here because he doesn't remember doing this because it wasn't particularly noteworthy to him when he did it.
Right.
Because it was probably such normal, drunken teenage behavior that it's not even something he remembers.
Right.
But I think he does remember enough to know that he probably did this. I think he doesn't trust himself to know that he didn't. Look. The big thing here that we're not really talking about is which kind of, you know, feeds into both narratives on both sides. This is really like an indictment of our past. It's an indictment of the 80s when this shit happened all the time. There's a movie called The Illustrator. I don't know if I've ever told you this. I watched it in art school because I was an illustration major. It's a movie where at one point in the film, which is not a comedy, a girl goes into a room because she's too drunk at a party, and then a sleazy guy follows her into that room. And everyone watching this movie when I was in college around like 2000 thought that that was some sort of subplot, that the fact that this girl was going to get raped.
Mm-hmm.
And then the teacher had to explain to us, oh, that wasn't part of the plot. That was a joke. That was what was considered a joke mm-hmm. in the 70s. A girl got too drunk and a guy went to fuck her in the room. Like, and like only 20 something years later, we were like horrified. Like we couldn't believe that that even counted as that. So.
Well, you don't think this stuff goes on right now?
Of course it goes on now, but it wasn't even considered by the public to be a crime then. And that's not to say that that's an excuse. I'm not saying that's an excuse. I'm saying that this is exactly the kind of change we need, where we look back at things and say, just because everyone was doing it does not mean it was okay. I mean, it's like Revenge of the Nerds. In 1984, that movie, those guys were the heroes. And by today's standards, they would all be sex criminals. They would all be on Megan's Law the rest of their lives. I think that's what we really have to talk about is that this behavior was normal for drunken high school students in the 80s because we just had a culture that told women that that's what they were for and that's why they didn't go anywhere with it. The idea of a woman going to the police over this in the 80s, it doesn't make sense because she probably would have been laughed out of half the police stations as, what are you here for? You just said you got away.
Yeah. Yeah.
This is exactly what we needed. As a country, we need to have this conversation because this is happening and has happened forever.
We had this conversation sort of kind of 2 years ago before the debate when Trump brought in all the women who were harassed by Bill and we had the Access Hollywood tape. We thought we had this conversation 2 years ago.
It can't just be about one guy. I think that you know, this is big part of the Time's Up or Me Too movement. The idea that we're at a different place now where women are being believed at least more, if not, you know, certainly not the level that maybe we should be, but at least we see the difference between this and Anita Hill. Because you look back at Anita Hill, and once again, who in God's name thinks Anita Hill was lying? Come on. She couldn't have been a more credible witness, just like Dr. Ford.
And they had an FBI investigation. President.
Well, because they wanted it then, because they believed they could win it. And because it was more recent allegations. So I know on some level, you know, they probably thought that there were, and it was in Washington. They thought they may have had more control over it. But now, yes, they're acting like they are all acting like they know he's guilty. They're all acting like they.
Well, he's acting like he knows he's guilty. He cannot say under questioning that he wants the FBI to look into it. He couldn't bring himself to say, yeah, I'll take a lie detector test. Yeah, let's wait a week and have the FBI look into these allegations. He can't bring himself to say that.
You know, and Mark Judge doesn't want to say it under oath. He doesn't want to put himself in that position. I think Kavanaugh, if I really am going to just, you know, try to read the guy's mind, I don't know what he's thinking. If I really look at the way he was testifying, I feel like I'm watching a guy who mighty. I think it seems like he is kind of remorseful, even though he won't admit it. I feel like behind his eyes, this is a guy who's like, wow, I really did destroy my life when I was a kid. And I'm willing to believe that he spent his entire adult life just being a bad person politically and not hurting women physically. But it doesn't matter if he did this. We should be allowed to talk about it. We should be allowed to say, does that bar you from a position that is so unbelievably important?
Well, and if when you're a judge, you have the arrogance of a surgeon, you have to. So he's got this self-determination and he can't be wrong. And he's incapable of reflection, introspection. He's petulant. He's a only child. He's spoiled, driven. Nobody's going to get in his way. He revealed himself to be one of the most despicable people I've ever seen come out of the system.
The way he, as a judge before all this happened, I thought he was just a terrible, terrible example of a judge, the way he abused power when it came to denying women abortions, not because the law said so, because he had the opportunity to do so. And when I said remorseful, I meant in the sense that, like, I think I see in his face a guy who's like, fuck, 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 what did I do? You know, because he came so close to getting what he always wanted. But doesn't he just seem like the aging frat boy? Doesn't he just seem like a guy who gleefully took what he wanted in life?
Yeah.
I don't know.
He took what he wanted. Whereas Clarence Thomas, and I do believe Clarence Thomas lied, and I do believe he sexually harassed Anita Hill. I don't think he laid a hand on her. I don't think he raped her. I do know that there were other women who wanted to come forward to claim they were harassed by Clarence Thomas, but they shut them up. The difference between Clarence Thomas and this guy is more men are guilty of what Clarence Thomas did, especially men of that age, than Brett Kavanaugh. Very few men have done what Brett Kavanaugh has done. Clarence Thomas, a lot of guys had to reassess how they behaved in the workplace.
I would say there are more Clarence Thomases in the world than Brett Kavanaughs in terms of what they did, but there are a lot of Brett Kavanaughs. And there certainly I would like to believe there were more in the past, but that doesn't say that we don't have a major, massive problem with entitled young boys. I know there are stories every day right now. I mean, I hear stories from, you know, people in college today about how men just push and push and push, trying to take advantage of a woman's just sort of desire not to be
to hurt your feelings,
not confrontational. Like they take advantage of your natural inclination to just, you know, please people and not fight people. And there are some people who are just too, I don't want to use the word weak, but just they don't have the wherewithal. They don't have the strength to push back hard enough. And these guys are goddamn bulldozers. And everyone complains about they're afraid to hit on women. You should be a little more afraid to, if this is what's happening. If this is how these sexual encounters end up, when you get a whiff of vulnerability, then yeah, you should be more scared.
Yeah.
And I saw a very scared looking man today in Brett Kavanaugh. I saw a man who was lashing out in fear and anger. I saw a man who was putting on a bit of a show because, much like Lindsey Graham has noticed, the more emotion you show, the more Republican people at home trust you.
Yeah.
It's sort of a weird thing that I thought we had outgrown hundreds of years ago and has come back. Yeah. I don't know. I watch this whole thing and it really makes me mad. They always make it about themselves. They always make it about, you know, I'm the real victim here. Like I said, he might think he's the real victim here, not because he doesn't think he did it, but because he thinks that it's being taken out of context, and that context is everyone did it when I was a kid.
And the anger is very disturbing. This is going to be a judge, or he is a judge. The rage, the sense of entitlement. Can you imagine Republicans rallying behind Clarence Thomas 30 years ago if he flashed that rage? Angry black man behaving that way?
That's because he's black, and the Republican Party would not have stood for an angry black man. I think that's a big part of it, and I think that's part of why, you know, we're trusting Dr. Ford a little bit more than Anita Hill, maybe. Even though that makes me sick, because, you know, I look at Anita Hill and I just think I don't understand how any human being could listen to her speak and ascribe any of the racist tropes that racists use against, you know, black people. You know, this is looking back on it, because I was a child, I know that people were saying terrible things. Then you actually look at this woman, it's like, you, Anita Hill was the kind of woman that everyone wants their kids to grow into. She was a perfect example of someone that should be standing in front of Congress and telling you something you should trust. And same with Dr. Ford. But I'm a bit of a tangent. Like, I saw a commercial this week telling me not to believe a rape victim.
Right.
On television from the Judicial Crisis Network, which, by the way, is a net. I decided to look up who made this commercial. It was made by a special interest group, I guess. I forgot the exact word. Do you know who owns that, who founded it?
No.
One of Clarence Thomas's clerks. So someone who worked for Clarence Thomas, an ally of Clarence Thomas, is making commercials telling us not to believe Dr. Ford.
It's ugly business.
Yeah. And speaking of ugly business – sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, go ahead.
Speaking of ugly business, the one complaint the Republicans keep going to is, why didn't Dianne Feinstein rat this woman out before she wanted to go public?
They had a beat up on a woman. They found Dianne Feinstein. That's – you know, you can't energize the base – unless you're beating up on some woman.
Well, their big argument is, the big moral high ground the Republicans are trying to take is, if you had reported this a few weeks earlier, we could have done this without it delaying the vote. And it wouldn't. And it's basically like, oh, well, you timed this to make it the worst possible situation. Well, maybe that's true. And maybe this woman simply did not want to go public on your timetable. But if it's true, dude, tough shit. You shouldn't have tried to rape someone.
Yeah.
This is a dirty business we work in. You know, dirty tricks. You didn't let Obama appoint a guy for a year. And you're going to complain that we didn't give you the rape victim at the exact day you wished you had it?
Right. Right.
These babies are just trying to put an emotional show of this. Meanwhile, Dr. Ford is ice cold. You can't touch this woman. She came off like the most credible, believable woman. You saw a woman who, like, oh, of course you passed a polygraph. This woman, because that's why you have to know who to trust here. Brett Kavanaugh hasn't thought about doing this since the night he drunkenly did it. Dr. Ford has been thinking about this every night for the rest of her frickin' life.
Right. Yeah.
Who do you think has a better memory of it?
And the fascism at play here, where no FBI investigation, no lie detector, we're voting. We don't care what the public thinks. Do you think Flake is going to vote no today?
You know what? I think he is.
Oh, really? He's always come across as a moderate, level-headed, critical of Trump, but he's never voted that way.
Flake's on his way out, right?
Well, he's running for president. He's going to challenge Trump. Supposedly, he's dipping his toe into Iowa and New Hampshire for 2020.
As a what?
As a Republican.
What, primary?
Yeah.
As to out-primary Trump. Well, the thing is,
supposedly,
if he wants to win a Republican primary, he doesn't want to deprive them of that seat. But if he wants to take the moral high ground, run as the opposite of a Trump Republican, then maybe it's the stance he needs. I mean, it certainly would put his name out there. I mean, it's not like he'd be the only person who is looking at this as an opportunity to jumpstart the campaign. Mm-hmm. And not that there's anything wrong with that. You know, that's simply the game you play. But I mean, look at someone like Cory Booker. You know, Cory Booker is very obviously interested in a 2020 run. And this is an opportunity for him to show people that he can be tough when he spoke to Kavanaugh.
Kamala Harris, the senator from California, who used to be the attorney general over there, she was impressive. I thought she was a little more impressive than Cory Booker, although he acquitted himself pretty nicely.
Hey, look, this is – you don't get that many opportunities to show the world, you know, who you are. And I think that they should be using this. And, I saw both of them. I thought they were both doing a good job. I mean, I like Kamala Harris a little bit more than I like Cory Booker in terms of just, you know, politicians and who's got aspirations for the presidency. But no, I thought they did fine. And this is what you're supposed to do.
What do you think of Lindsey Graham? He rallied.
What the hell happened to Lindsey Graham? What happened to the guy who was trying to be the last Republican with a spine? And suddenly he's this breathless, you know, just emotional mess talking about a con job or such words about this. It's very odd. It's very odd. You're talking about him threatening, saying that, oh, anyone can get sexual harassment claims. And mm-hmm. you better worry because now we're going to put one up against your next candidate.
Yeah.
He really – he's acting like Trump, where Trump is like, oh, well, you think George Washington never raped anyone? and Lindsey Graham is doing the same thing. Lindsey Graham is up there being like, oh, well, you watch out because whoever you pick next – yeah, how about we don't pick a rapist?
Yeah.
How about you don't pick someone who you have any chance of doing this? And if you do pick someone who's a rapist, you pick someone else.
Pick a better rapist.
I don't think Trump picked Kavanaugh because he raped someone, but that doesn't mean that we have to – like that doesn't mean we have to approve him anyway. Look, when Democrats in the modern age find someone to have done anything untoward with women, right now they leave office because we're trying to lead by example a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
If a Democrat was accused of this, they would simply get a new candidate.
And they cut bait with Al Franken.
Yes.
Yeah.
Al Franken was our sacrificial lamb to show that we have standards and they don't. Al Franken was there to say the Democrats don't stand for this. We're not going to just be a double standard. Lindsey Graham thinks he's going to be president because he's just trying to see how emotional he can get. It's embarrassing. It's like when he was running for president and he had that video of himself hitting his phone with his baseball bat. It was a joke.
Lindsey Graham is a Republican. He is in the closet, and
that's what they say. Yeah.
Well, it's a fact, and he has a boyfriend. We know that for a fact. He's openly gay in Washington D.C. He's closeted in South Carolina, and here he was, a Republican in the closet, telling and convincing his fellow Republicans that Brett Kavanaugh is telling them the truth about his sexual proclivities. That's how low the Republican Party has sunk, that low where they're depending on a closeted gay man to convince them that another man is telling them the truth about sex. Pretty
well
bad.
Lindsey Graham is broken. Lindsey Graham is now saying all that matters is that we get this guy in the court and anything we do to get him there is worth it. They just don't want to have this conversation about personal morality anymore because they've had a real problem with it the last few years with their major politicians, with their candidates.
What'd you think of the sex crimes prosecutor Rachel Mitchell from Arizona? I thought she did a pretty good job questioning Dr. Ford.
Yeah, I thought – I didn't see anything she did that I found particularly inappropriate. I thought that she acted like someone who did this for a living.
Yeah.
And I'm glad that she was in that position.
And then they silenced her.
What do you mean?
Well, they had her asking the questions in the morning, and then in the afternoon, they felt...
Oh, you mean that she didn't speak to Kavanaugh?
But yeah, he tried to hold his hand over her mouth. And
yeah. Well, I was going to say, I mean, that's the exact... The exact thing is, like, are we shocked that we didn't have Kavanaugh speaking to the person who I mean, that's what her normal job would be. She would spend more of her time talking to the accused, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I thought no one's surprised by that. But it's sort of almost cute to be like, oh, yes, of course. You're not going to make him talk to the prosecutor. Why would he ever do that? He's a judge.
Yeah.
By the way, did you notice when Lindsey Graham said he felt ambushed by her testimony?
Yeah.
Ambushed. You know, like when you grab someone and drag them into a room.
Mm-hmm.
When, turn on the music really loud so no one can hear. Is that what it felt like, Lindsey?
Uh-huh.
Let's not forget the calendars. The calendars. Poor Bill Cosby. If only he knew, he just had to write, didn't rape anyone in his calendar.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, no, I didn't rape this girl. I would have written it down in my diary.
Yeah. On my to-do list.
Jesus, I cannot believe this is real.
Yeah.
And all I know is with Lindsey Graham, I'm just like, dude, bring it on. The accusation that we're going to get your next guy and we're going to find someone to say that he raped someone. Jesus Christ, I cannot believe this is our government now.
Yeah. Yep. Who are these women waiting decades to charge Brett Kavanaugh with sexual assault think they are?
You're a professor, you're a doctor, you have a great life, a nice family. Why not get a bunch of death threats?
Yeah.
And Trump, you know, that you saw Trump in his press conference say that every woman who accused him was given money. I mean, what Trump's press conference is something we should definitely talk about, because
he is a raw genius. He's despicable, but you can't take your eyes off it.
Number one, he's running out of steam. He did not seem like he was happy.
Oh, I thought he was energized by it.
No, I see. I thought I looked at that guy as a guy who just doesn't like this anymore.
People see what they want to see. I see a guy who's enjoying another man's pain, another woman's pain, and a fight. I thought he was turned on by the whole thing. And I think a lot of men watch Brett Kavanaugh, and a lot of women watch Brett Kavanaugh, and they're forced to look at themselves. And the guys go, am I Brett Kavanaugh? And if I am, I sure as hell hope he gets to sit on the Supreme Court, because that would be an indictment of me. And the women watching Brett Kavanaugh are thinking, am I married to Brett Kavanaugh? Is my boyfriend or husband Brett Kavanaugh? Well, they better let him sit on the Supreme Court, because if he can't, then I have to question whether or not the guy I'm sharing my bed with, I got to question whether or not he's a...
Yeah, it's a can of worms that people don't want to open. It's sort of like when Me Too started and some people were saying, look, if we keep going with this, we're going to have to bulldoze all of Hollywood Boulevard. But is that really a reason not to?
It's the reason to do it. It's good. Like, get rid of these guys. If you're a man, you benefit if they get rid of these guys.
Yeah, more jobs.
Yeah, get rid of Les Moonves.
Why not?
Yeah.
I mean, it's as people say, we're working in comedy. If people lose jobs, that's just more jobs.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, it's not that big a deal, especially this is mostly done by men in power, the exact people who create a nice vacuum. So, yeah, screw it. Screw them. I mean, I think you and I are in the same boat. We're like, hey, I never put my hand over a woman's mouth and try to rip her skirt off. So why should I feel bad for you if you're going to lose the job that, frankly, I wouldn't mind having?
Dave Sirus, what is the name of your podcast?
Oh, The David Feldman Show, every Friday.
No, what is the name of your podcast?
Blame Storming. We had a very nice episode this week.
Good.
With Richie Redding and Brucker, a very good – we have a lawyer, an in-house lawyer now. We can ask questions, and we also get – which I'm working on a doctor who can give scripts. But the show's fun. Go ahead and listen.
Okay. And how do people follow you on Twitter?
Dave Sirus. It's spelled like virus with an S.
I see. All right. Very good. Well, hang on. Cops raid shares Malibu mansion and make an arrest.
Share?
Yeah. Let's see.
Oh, my God. Is Cher okay?
It's the son of one of her assistants. Nothing to worry about.
Wow, fascinating. Yeah. That is big news, huh?
Yes. All right. Stay on the line for 1 second, sir. If you're enjoying today's show, do me a favor and subscribe to it on iTunes, Stitcher. We have a YouTube channel. It's just audio, but some people like to listen to this show on YouTube, so subscribe to our YouTube channel and do me a favor and give us a good review on iTunes. You'd be amazed how much that helps. Giving us a good review on iTunes moves us up. That's the way their algorithm works. So when you give us a good review on iTunes, you're really helping out.